Yeah, so now,
yeah,
of course, because we love physics, we have to talk about Newton, right? So you're probably wondering, okay, when you're moving in a straight line, you can experience forces and all these things. Okay, perfect. Well, as we just described, there is such a thing as angular acceleration. And if you remember from a previous episode, which I don't exactly remember which episode it was, we talked about inertial terms.
Oh, Newton's,
which I think,
Newton's laws.
Yeah, 100%. Probably.
Where else would we have talked about it?
I don't know. But we talked about inertial terms. And when it comes to rotation, it's not as easy as just saying the mass. It is that easy when you're dealing with, you know, one-dimensional motion, just moving in a straight line, because the mass, all the particles in that mass will be moving in the same direction. You know, they'll have the same vector velocity vector. I don't know why I said that twice. But everything is going to move at the same time, at the same rate, in the same direction, all that stuff. And so all you're really concerned about is the center of mass. You pretend as if everything was, like, the entire mass of the body was concentrated in one spot at the center of mass, and it had the mass of the body. Boom. That's all you need. But rotation is a little bit more complicated, because you have situations where I can rotate my body around an axis that is centered in my body. Like, I can rotate around my spinal cord, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And if you look at every single particle in my body, some particles are going to be moving faster than others, which means that you can't consider every single particle to be identical in this case. And so, as you probably guessed, the inertial term actually depends on the actual axis of rotation and the distribution of mass.
Mm-hmm.
So, for example, if I'm rotating around an axis on my spinal cord, you know, just like spinning around, I'm going to have a different moment of inertia than if I was rotating around the sun. You know what I mean? So I guess we can talk a little bit more in depth about that when we get to energy and then like torque and things like that,
mm-hmm.
which, yeah, torque is I alpha. So it translates directly to, like, from the Newton's equations.
Mm-hmm. So I is very, I mean, I comes very in very many places, including like when we're calculating for energy and stuff like that as well, right? Like, again, translating between the translational and the rotational terms, I is, again, okay, I don't fully remember if you said this, but I is basically the rotational version of mass, right? So in your half mv squared for your kinetic energy formula, if you're trying to calculate the kinetic energy for any moving body, you just switch it up. It's half I omega squared, where I is basically your moment of inertia, which is now representing your mass, and omega, which is your rotational velocity. So again, it's a very easy switch to just get these through. Again, showing you that physics works. Showing you that physics works.
I don't know if I remember this exactly.
What? Okay.
But so the moment, okay, I'm going to try to remember and like derive it live, okay? So
okay.
The moment of inertia of a single point mass is mr squared, right? So the mass of the point multiplied by the distance squared. Is that correct? I think so.
Well, it's the sum of all the masses, right? It depends on the distribution.
I'm talking about one point.
Oh, okay, then yes.
mr squared. And so if you have a continuous distribution, you have to take the integral of r squared dm, right? I think that's right. Because you have to multiply the distance r squared times each infinitesimal mass point in the continuous distribution.
Yes, because you're basically integrating it, remember?
Yeah. And so that's how you calculate any distribution. Of course, there are hard distributions to do. For example, the human body. would be difficult to integrate over because it's so, I mean, it's symmetrical in a way, but just so overly complicated. What we did do in class and things like distributions, distributions that we did in class that were pretty easy to derive were, for example, spheres, balls that were filled in, you know what I mean? Also planes, like not flying planes, but like two-dimensional flat planes. Also cylinders and things like that. And those are easy, but also interesting to go through, especially the first time you do it, because you'll notice that some axes are easier to do than others. For example, a sphere rotating around just its central axis is different from, this is a bad example because the sphere is completely symmetrical. What about a cylinder? So if you stick the axis through the top of the cylinder, that moment of inertia is going to be different than if you were to like skewer it from the side and it would rotate like a propeller. And so you can do these calculations with the integral that I just mentioned earlier. Mm-hmm. Some, of course, are easier than others.